guess.
Hello, I'm Gunnar Oswald, the Programs Chair with the Chesapeake Chapter. And today we have Dave Rico. He's going to give us a continuing education on Agile. He's been working on Agile for over 10 years. And I know that when he started working it, it was a concept that wasn't well accepted. I think he just mentioned to me today, he said, well, it's well accepted. What's the next buzzword? You know, so, but it's not well implemented yet. And that's one thing he wanted to talk about, how now that we've got the software engineers and the system engineers, which we gave presentations previously on, now how is the organization going to support Agile? So Dave, talk a little bit about yourself and.
All right, thank you for coming out again here today. My name is Dave Rico. This is actually my third NCOC talk here at Chesapeake, probably my fifth or sixth NCOC in total. Thanks for coming out. We're going to talk a little bit about the notion of really organizational or business agility. I didn't want to limit it just to business agility because I wanted to show the applicability to all types of organizations and enterprises, even government agencies. You know, but that's really what we're here to talk a little bit about. Is the notion of agile organizational designs. You know, most people, you know me. I've been in the public sector for a little more than three decades, mostly large government projects, NASA, Air Force, Navy. Been here at Fort Meade for just a little bit over 15 years in their systems engineering department. Still there. I went from really doing risk assessments of their big programs. Now we're doing road mapping and integrated master scheduling of mostly of their cloud portfolio and things like that. So let's go ahead and dive right into the topic here, you know, without further ado. So the notion of organizational agility is rather quite old. It's really about a 25-year-old concept. Really? So when lean thinking sort of kind of reached its heyday in the 1980s, about 1990, the thought leaders of the day, including people like Rick Dove, who was a professor at Stevens Institute of Technology, were asking questions, what's next? What's beyond lean thinking? And sort of they invented the word of business agility. And Rick Dove was one of the first authors in this particular era. That was nearly 25 or 26 years ago, all right? But something sort of kicked off the pendulum, right, of business agility. But it really didn't reach full effect until the modern time, right? Because we started out with Agile at the team level, and we get things like Scrum, and we got things like Agile project management, and Agile portfolio management. Now people are saying, that's great, we know how to do systems development in an agile way. We know how to do project and portfolios, but how do we manage entire organizations in this particular paradigm? And that's really what we're here to answer about today. I had agile enthusiasts asking me questions 10 or 12 years ago, like, great, the team is agile, but my organization is not. Help. What do I do? And that's, unfortunately, fast forward 10 years later, that's the question we're here to try to answer here today. So it's I really kind of like this quote. To me, it really sort of embodies sort of the principle, the paradigm, the theory of business agility. It's a famous quote by Mike Tyson, right? And he says, everybody has a plan until I punch him in the mouth. Right, and really, I can't remember what his fastest knockout was ever, like 6 seconds or something like that. He was one of the greatest boxers of his time, he really was. And that sort of kind of really embodies when the market punches you in the mouth, when your customers punch you in the mouth, you've got all these wonderful technologies and networks and enterprise architectures and integrated master schedules and road maps and things like that, portfolios, and you've got all these wonderful methodologies, but the market's going to come at you from a different angle that you plan. And what are you going to do next? How are you going to adapt to that change? And how are you going to ultimately succeed? And that's really what the notion of the Agile organization was. Really, you know, it sort of kind of emerged from the concepts of Agile manufacturing. So for the first 100 years, you know, sort of when Fordism kind of took off about 100 years ago, their biggest concern was, how do I manufacture a lot of things consistently and cost effectively? And that was the biggest challenge. So about 50 years ago, people said, well, it's great. We know how to manufacture a lot of things cost effectively in a timely manner, but can we do this in a flexible manner? Can I have a product line or a set of factories that can handle multiple products simultaneously? Or if I invent a new product, can I reconfigure a factory to handle a new platform architecture? So people started thinking about 50 years ago of the notion of flexible manufacturing. And that's really where Lean kind of took its foothold in the 1980s, and where Agile methods took their foothold in the 1990s, right? And I like some of these quotes. We're not going to go through all of them, you know, but I think my second favorite quote is the one by George Patton, right? General George Patton, right? One of his, I mean, the guy is just, he's got hundreds of famous quotes, but this is the one I like. He said, a good plan violently executed today is better than a perfect plan tomorrow. So he liked to gather his people and say, what does the battlefield look like today? Where are the tanks? Where are the Germans? Where are the armaments? Where are the airfields? And what do you think we should do today? And they said, well, we ought to think about this for a few weeks, and we ought to gather some more intelligence, and we ought to come up with an ironclad plan. And of course, we need logistics, and we need a fail-safe plan, and we need a backup plan, and a plan C. He said, no, just tell me where the weakest point in the enemy lines is today, and we'll attack that. And then based on their response, we'll regather and we'll reevaluate. And that method worked really, really well. So we like to sort of credit George Patton as sort of one of the original Agile thinkers. Actually, the British like to credit Winston Churchill as one of the original, you know, Agile thinkers. There's actually a book. I was going to give it away today, but I didn't. It was my only copy, and I was being very, very stingy and greedy. But there's actually a book called Winston Churchill, the First Agile Project Manager. So let's go ahead and continue. I think if I wanted to, you know, point to one other quote here, it's one of my favorites. I kind of highlighted in blue. He said, the herd instinct among forecasters makes sheep seem like independent thinkers. Right? And this is actually a true statement. We call this in the field of organizational psychology or organizational behavior groupthink. Right? You get a bunch of people in the room, and they start actually agreeing with one another, even if they're agreeing to the wrong thing. Right? And so our plans and our architectures and our systems actually start answering the wrong question or an obsolete question, and nobody in the room wants to disagree with the current strategy. Right? And even if we get to the point, we're actually getting to the point, the science of decision making is actually getting pretty good, where we know how to identify a dissenting opinion and come up with a better alternate strategy. The point is, though, that if I invest in a strategy and I identify a dissenting position and I come up with a better strategy, how quickly can I reconfigure my organization to pursue the superior course of action, right? And there's investment, there's cost wrapped up in that, and there's psychology wrapped up in that, right? Okay, so really, it's really kind of come to fruition. This is really the manifestation of Rick Dove's dream here. You know, once you've identified, once a new situation has presented itself and you've identified a superior course of action, how do I get 10,000 people to change direction and pursue that superior solution? And that's what we're here to talk about today. And I'm not going to go through this slide. I did this the last time, but I just want to point out to, you know, some of the challenges that today's organizations face, you know, competition and demanding customers and downsizing. For us in the systems engineering world, it's system complexity, right? If our systems or our portfolios or our organizations are too complex, we're not very, very flexible, right? We're not very, very flexible. But technology change continues to dog us, right? You know, technology's become far too obsolete far too quickly, right? You know, it's not long, you know, before I buy the latest and greatest smartphone before it's actually obsolete. As a matter of fact, today my cell phone is two generations obsolete, right? By the time I buy it, it's two generations obsolete, right? Okay, so we're having a hard time in the world keeping up with the pace of technological change. And if you're an organization that has hundreds or thousands of technologies and projects and portfolios and people, I'm going to curse a little bit, you have no chance in hell. Okay, so that's what we're talking about, is giving today's organizations a snowball's chance in hell of surviving in the marketplace. Right? And I'll come back to that in a minute. But there are other things. These are actually DoD factors, right? Obviously, our budgets are dogging us, right? Even the technology and skills, right? If the technologies are changing faster than we can, our people can't keep up with them. And this particularly bites us in the intelligence community, right? Where the price of admission is so high that the people with the relevant technology skills can't come into our community fast enough, right? So it puts pressure on the community itself to maintain its relevance, right? And obviously, as we scale out to the global community, and we'll talk a little bit more about this in a minute, obviously, security is sort of kind of coming into center stage, right? It's great that you can build that system, but can you do it in a secure fashion, right? Right? So these are just some of the factors, but the factor that I want to point out at today, I think, yes, technology and change is dogging today's organization, but this is the factor this is what I call the dinosaur killer. This is what I call an extinction level event. If you cannot be an organization and survive under these conditions, you cannot be an organization. Let me explain what this slide says here. There are about 7.5 billion people in the world, okay? Nearly half of them are connected to the internet, exchanging trillions of packets, right? All right? Nearly one-third of them are on social media, which is causing a real revolution in the Middle East, right? Okay. Mobile users, there are nearly 4 billion active mobile phone users in the world, right? Subscriptions in the world, right? With dozens or hundreds of applications, there is a portfolio of systems on this system right here, okay? So if you're an organization, let's say Verizon or Sprint or Samsung or Apple, you are faced with maintaining and evolving all of the subsystems on this system of systems for 4 billion people in real time, right? That means if you have to roll out an application, if you're Samsung and you need a new operating system, you literally have to push it out to 4 billion platforms, and you have to do it right. Not for one application, for hundreds of applications in fractions of a second. And if you screw it up, you've got to recall it and reset 4 billion cell phones back to their original state in real time. And you've got to do it in a secure fashion. Wow. So this is what I call, again, an extinction level event. If you can't do that with your organizational design today, you cannot be an organization. I met a gentleman who I thought was insane about a decade ago in Hawaii, who said the only people who can survive in today's marketplace are Google, Yahoo, perhaps Amazon and eBay, and everybody else can't survive in today's marketplace. Of course, I thought he was insane. He was a University of Boston PhD student. It hit me the other day that he was absolutely right, because these are the only people that are serving, simultaneously serving 4 billion users in real time. These are the only people with the technologies and the capabilities and the processes and the enterprises and the systems engineering capabilities to do so, right? The rest of us are just playing catch up, right? The rest of us are just pretending like we can, right? We're free riders, right? We're free riders. That's what we're called, right? So what we're talking about is the ability to be like them, right? So I ask myself, if all these hypotheses are correct, right, that there are just so many global forces that are putting pressure on today's, and if the world is scaling up to billions of simultaneously internetworked users, we should be able to see the economic effect of these forces on businesses, on enterprises, not just projects. We've already seen the Standish statistics. I don't have to pull them up for the millionth time. We all know that 60 to 70% of today's projects are failing, right? But what about enterprises? What about businesses, right? Well, we've actually seen that. So really, there's actually four graphs here, and I didn't want four different slides. So this is actually Kurzweil's curve. So Gordon Moore told us in about 1970 that the technology or the size of a microprocessor would halve in size and double in speed about every 18 months. Well, Kurzweil said about 15 years ago that the rate of change was not linear, but it was log linear. It was exponential, right? And he called the point when the rate of change would be so small, so infinitesimal, that would be, the rate of change would be fractions of a second. He called that point the singularity. And he predicted about 15 years ago that the singularity would occur in about 2050. Well, ladies and gentlemen, the singularity has occurred, right? When Samsung could literally update, 200 applications in a fraction of a second, okay? For 4 billion cell phone users, then the singularity has occurred. It occurred faster than even Ray Kurzweil could predict in 1999, right? Okay, all right. So that's sort of the technological trend that's happening, and it's gonna get worse, right? So what's happening is the rate of change is increasing exponentially. But now let's switch to the field of psychology. Well, Virginia Satir told us, this is also known as the Kubler-Ross curve, right? Okay. Virginia Satir told us that when there's a dramatic change, that is, there's chaos, you change the system, right? There's a defect, you update, you upgrade, you change the technology, you change the version. When there's a dramatic change, that chaos ensues, right? All right. You actually destabilize the system, right? All right, and it performs at a lower rate of performance while it's in its state of destabilization until you fix the system, and then it reaches a higher rate of performance. So we see these two effects of change, right? We see the singularity, and we see the the onset of chaos when the change happens, right? But we should also see this impacting businesses and organizations as well, right? So what I did was I looked for a simple curve showing the rate of business failures from 1992 to 2002, and we actually see that from 1992, this is US businesses, we actually saw a 71% loss in US businesses, right? Of course, this was the internet boom. There was a lot of technological change that was going on, right? And I said, but is there any recent evidence? Does this trend continue? Did it destabilize? Well, this is actually the trend from 2000 to 2010. So we actually see in the services industry, which we've known this for at least 40 or 50 years, in the services industry, the rate of business failure is only 56%. But in the manufacturing industry, the rate of failure almost remains a constant 71% failure. What this means, and this is probably fairly conservative, if you're going to manufacture a piece of hardware, there's a 71% chance you're going to fail. Excuse me? In perhaps, if not sooner. Right? So this is kind of what's happening here. Technology is changing too fast. Organizations are too rigid. Portfolios are too complex. Processes are too slow and outdated. There's too many people. There's too many governance structures, and we just can't move fast enough, right? Yes, sir.
When you define business failures, a company closing down, going bankrupt, or a product that just got eclipsed by the swift change in technology.
Business going out of business, bankrupt. Not being purchased, technology not or product not being. So thus, you know, we see an increased demand. So people have come around and said, well, wait a minute, if businesses are more flexible and more adaptable, right, and their processes can adapt to these changes, well, you know, maybe we can hope to deal with these some. So people have been pursuing this notion of organizational agility for quite some time, right? And these are actually global surveys. They say, well, why do you want your business to be agile, right? And we ask people, why do you want your business to be agile? And these are some of the responses we get, right? To give a faster response to changing market conditions, right? All right? This doesn't just affect Samsung and Apple and Google and Yahoo, right? This affects the DoD, Uncle Sam, the intelligence community, right? The threat, the people that are buying those cell phones are not just good guys trying to buy books on Amazon. They're bad guys trying to, you know, steal our credit cards, you know, and hack our networks and bring down our satellites and our UAVs, right? And they're destabilizing the system too, right? So you've got to be able to thwart those risks. Once those risks have occurred, right, and you've identified those risks, you've got to thwart those risks, and you've got to do it quickly. Right? And you've got to move on to the next threat. You can't dwell on that threat. Right? Okay?
So is there a role for automation
and systems to become
smarter and smarter?
Yes. Was that Eric?
Yes.
So Eric asked the question, is there a role for automation? Yes. So the sort of the new paradigm for automating some of these effects are DevOps, right? Okay, so yes, there's all kinds of things. Absolutely. So automation does play a big role, but so does organizational design. So great, but this is not a DevOps talk. I just gave a DevOps talk. This is about organizational design. All right. So you've already seen this slide. I won't talk about it. So, you know, what is the notion of agility? Well, you saw it in the survey. We want to be able to respond to change. As the technology change, as the threats change, as the market changes, how quickly can I reconfigure not my manufacturing line, but my organization, right? Quickly reprioritize my resources and give a fast response, right? And that's sort of the notion of agility, right? Okay? So we already know that that's sort of kind of the notion of agile methods or agile thinking, as I call it. But how does this translate to the organization, the business, the enterprise, right? Well, this is just a very, we're gonna go through that in a little bit more in depth in just a few minutes, but let's stay at the surface for just a couple of seconds longer, right? This is actually a model created by PricewaterhouseCoopers of what they considered an agile organization, right? There's sort of three dimensions, right? Sort of the strategic responsiveness. This is sort of the executive boardroom. These are the people making the decisions, right? Like your directors and your CTOs, what I call C-level executives, right? How really responsive or agile or flexible are they? And we've known that for a long time. We're going to see a little bit more of that, right? And then down at the lower rung, what about your organization? Great, just because an executive can identify a new market or enemy threat and say, let's do this, how fast can your organization respond to that order, right? Okay, and sort of in between are sort of the principles, right? Sort of the pillars of business agility. Is your ability to strategically replan, is that agile? Is your ability to iterate through this problem, is your ability to move quickly and just adapt your processes and your technologies and your structures? Because, you know, this goes right back to TQM. It's not about adapting one time. You don't just say, here's state one, a threat has occurred and it's transitioned me to state two, and how fast did I get to state two? Therefore, I'm agile. Now, W. Edwards Deming didn't think that 100 years ago. You know, he called quality improvement continuous improvement, right? It's your ability to continuously change. Think of this as the threat change hole. As the threats, as the market changes, as your priorities, how quickly can you change? Well, Samsung and Apple and Google and Yahoo can change a lot, all right? Okay, I believe it's Amazon Web Services does about 10,000 changes to their entire baseline each day. Okay? 10,000 changes to the entire baseline, right? So it's not just the ability, being able to adapt once is not agile. Being able to adapt relentlessly, is that agile? And can your organization do that? And I'm not going to take you through the dimensions, so we've known that agile, you know, covers more than one dimension. We're all familiar with, you know, the notion of agile methodologies like Scrum, or, you know, agile, you know, systems development like the scaled agile framework and things like that, right? And little known are really, you know, there was this notion of agile information technology, reconfigurable agile, you know, information systems in the 1980s, right? Well, we're starting to get a little bit better at this. We're not great at these, you know, everything from program analysis down to agile information technologies, but more and more the conversation is up at the organizational level, right? I just want to say, everybody says, well, where did the impetus for agility come from? It comes from so many dimensions, I can't even pinpoint it directly. I think we've already talked about it. If I were to point to one particular paradigm that sort of kind of spawned off the notion of organizational agility, it would probably have to be the notion of flexible manufacturing and lean thinking, right? But it didn't start there, right? It has to do with strategic planning and information technology. Didn't Eric say that, will automation help it? Well, the answer is yes. Right? Okay. But it also comes from some abstract ideas called evolutionary biology in complex adaptive systems, right? Organisms that can adapt to change, right? Most insects have been on this planet longer than we have, right? Roaches have been here for tens of millions of years, highly adaptable little creatures, at least resilient to change, right? So I'm not going to stop and go through this timeline, but I just want to show you that these are just about 15 or 16 books that directly address the topic of organizational or enterprise agility. And you can see that some of these date back to, you know, the late 1990s. This isn't a new topic. I'm not talking about a new topic here today. We're talking about really a topic that's sort of kind of reaching maturity. That's what this timeline is intended to show. I'm not going to go through this, but these are just from each one of those 18 textbooks. This was their definition of what it meant to be an agile enterprise, and actually highlighted them in the other version of this, but things like adaptability and fast cycle time, right? Okay, moving quickly and adapting to change were key parts. We already know that organizational change is really, really hard, and the bigger your organization, you know, the harder it is, right? Right? It lends credence to that old, you know, proverb, you know, the bigger you are, the harder you fall. That's a true statement. That's the Satir model. That's the Kubler-Ross model. The bigger you are, the harder you fall. Right? And we're going through that right now, right across the street, right? Right? We're going through that right across the street, right? But what's really interesting, so what I did was I dove into just these 15 models to see, well, what are these people calling organizational agility? And I apologize for the eye chart, but there's some real significant analysis on this chart, which can't be ignored, which is really sort of kind of signified by these cryptic little check marks, right? And if I could break their sort of suggestions for organizational agility into seven broad categories, and we've already seen this from the PricewaterhouseCoopers study, probably the first notion of organizational agility was, is your strategy adaptable to change? Are your C-level executives adaptable to change, right? And you see a bunch of check marks up here. And then sort of the next major wave of investigation is your culture adaptable to change? And the list goes on and on. Are your processes, systems engineering, project management, acquisition, purchasing, facilities, are your processes, hiring, adaptable to change, right? And then people kept on pressing further because the people who wrote these books really, really believed that if your strategy was flexible, you were flexible. And somebody said, no, your culture has to be flexible and your processes have to be flexible. Well, what about your products and your services, right? I mean, if your medium of communication is a little stone tablet in a bird kind of chipping away the newspaper like they do on the Flintstones, then your product and service technology isn't very flexible. But if your product and service technology is Morse code, right? Is a telegraph, well, that's pretty flexible. What about a telephone? What about a television? What about a radio? What about a microwave? Right? What about a cell phone? Right? Right? So our technologies, as Eric pointed out, our technologies are becoming more flexible, right? Not just our products, but so people say, well, maybe we can design our products so that they're flexible and adaptable to change. Well, what about the technologies that they're actually made of? That's great that you're going to invest in a flexible architecture, but what about the technologies? This is what Stefan Tomke wrote about in 2003. If you want to be agile, the technologies themselves have to be agile. They have to be flexible and malleable to change, right? But does it stop there? So now we have flexible executives and flexible technologies. Let's strike at the heart of the organization, right? What about the infrastructure itself, the network itself, right? What about the organizational design? Can I take a big bureaucratic, you know, behemoth with 17 levels of hierarchy and 30,000 people and say, thou shalt be agile? Is that even humanly possible? Right? What about the organization? Do we need to address that complexity, that bureaucracy? What about the capital infrastructure itself? Right? So what we're saying is that business agility or organizational agility or government agent agility is not just one of these dimensions, it's all of these dimensions simultaneously, right? So what are we trying to do? We're trying to, you know, respond to changing market conditions, to threats. We need to be cost effective, right? We need to be fast, we need to be cheap, right? We need to move at the speed of light, because we've got to do things billions at a time in fractions of a second, and we have to do it right the first time, right? And if we get it wrong because we're only human, we've got to recall it, reset a billion things at once. Right? Can your organization handle that? Right? So this is a pictorial version of that rather unpleasant eye chart. Well, this is not that much pleasing either. So we see the seven dimensions here of business or enterprise agility. It's, you know, not just, you know, flex, you know, C-level executives with flexible attitudes and flexible cultures, but it's processes and product architectures and technologies and infrastructure and so forth and so on, right? And if you kind of want to dive into some of these, so what do each one of these buzzwords mean, you can kind of dissect what some of those mean. At the strategy level, it might be, you know, your strategic objective and your visions, right? At the cultural level, it might be your people, right? Your communication structures. We all know what processes are. We're systems engineers, right? Okay. Again, we've talked about the notion of flexible architectures and flexible technologies. Oh, there's that S word, software. That's what Stefan Tomke said. He was telling American manufacturers in 2003, if you don't know who Stefan Tomke, Harvard professor, okay, Harvard. He would say, American manufacturers, you want to be flexible, use software, dump the hardware. That's what he said in 2003, okay? So it's not just software, but really the notion of microservices. That's what each one of these little 200 apps are on your mobile phone. It's a microservice. It's a type of microservice, right? But your infrastructure itself has to be flexible, and so does your organizational design. So what would be, so you know, we've seen this right here at Fort Meade. You know, when we created our corporate network, it was the first time we'd been internetworked completely, everybody simultaneously at one time in the history of our organization, right? We don't want to undo that. We don't want to undo that. That was a big gain 15 years ago. We don't want to do that, okay? Now people are saying it's not just enough to have all of your employees internetworked on one intranet, but why not just use commercial services? Today's organization, 70% of people in commercial and civilian sectors work from home, and the only information technology device they're given is either a laptop or a cell phone. And they lease that from Verizon and MCI and Sprint, right? It's the ultimate flexible infrastructure, and when it's obsolete, you just go get a new one, right? Okay, let's continue on. Ooh, I went the wrong way. So that's basically where we're kind of at the, you know, the rest of the slides just kind of dive into detail. You know, see Gundars or go to the website, you know, and see some of the detail of each of those boxes for a further elaboration. So this is a bigger version of everything we just said. Won't go there again, right? And if you want a few words to explain a lot of check boxes, that's a great chart right there. I had to throw in a little, spider chart in here just to show you can throw these dimensions, right, and a little radar chart, and you can actually measure your organizational agility, right? Spider charts are like 30 or 40 years. Everybody thinks they're great. You know, you can actually throw each of these major dimensions and minor dimensions, and you can do an assessment, right? And you can measure on these dimensions, you know, how flexible is your organization? So that's a way to measure organizational agility, right? This is actually an example. This is inspired. I actually heard a couple of DoD executives, I don't want to name any names, at a conference, a systems engineering conference a few years ago, and they were talking about one of the Pentagon's greatest struggle is how to achieve some of these goals and objectives of organizational, you know, flexibility. So actually, I came up with this chart before all the other materials to respond to their question, to their rhetorical question. Yes? Yes, go ahead. Okay, that's fine. We're actually almost done. I just wanted to give a couple of examples. I'm not going to go through these case studies. But that's great. Sounds theoretical. You're a doctor. Great for the halls of academia. This is the real world. You know, leave us alone. You know? No, this is the way real organizations operate. You know, it really is. Open source software community, right? 70% of the software today, open source, produced by programmers working out of their house, working for free. They power the internet. They power organizations like Microsoft and Google and Yahoo. Our big data centers are powered by open source, right? We downloaded it. We configured it and customized to perform our mission, right? Without the open source community, we couldn't even perform our mission. Apache, Hadoop, Cassandra, Mongo, the list goes on and on and on and on, right? We wouldn't even exist today without the ultimate flexible organization, the open source software. Universities are starting to operate like this. Actually, the largest single university in the university system of Maryland is UMUC, about 248,000 enrollments, right? 83,000 full-time students, most of them, 70-80%, online, from their home, doing their homework, their coursework, from home, at 3 o'clock in the morning. They actually grant nearly 12,000 degrees per year, right? And they're actually one of the largest minority degree granting institutions on the planet. They grant more minority degrees than HBCUs. All right, these are just some of the effects, you know, of, I'm not gonna go through this, right, okay? So when they start looking at, well, if you start measuring organizational agility, are rigid organizations better or worse than flexible ones? Well, they say that, flexible organizations actually, have, twice as many strategic initiatives. We actually see this in Hewlett-Packard data. Once they switch to an automated delivery system for all of their microcode, they freed up 80% of their manufacturing resources for innovation projects to explore new markets, right? So once they made their infrastructure automated, they took all that money away from their infrastructure and they gave it to their innovation engineers to explore bold new markets, right? And that's what we see kind of in the first statistic there, right? But we also see this in earlier MIT studies, which showed that flexible organizations had up to 40% better earnings than non-flexible ones, right? And that's just a detailed financial analysis behind the previous slide. We actually see this in the e-commerce. Remember the University of Boston student who said that only Google, Yahoo, and Amazon would survive into the 21st century, and we actually see that they actually have what is it, like double digit, you know, growth, which is like almost 10 times higher than brick and mortar organization. We actually see this playing out on GDP, right? Nations that have more flexible organizations have higher GDP than those that don't. So let's go ahead and wrap up right there so that we could give a few books away or answer a few questions, right? Okay, so what exactly are we talking about, right? Well, this isn't for software development. It's not just about Scrum, right? Okay, it's been around for a long time. I've said this over and over again, ad nauseum, right? We saw sort of in the yin and yang diagram, the triad, that agility is rooted in a lot of rich theoretical traditions. It wasn't born yesterday, right? You know, the whole lean and agile paradigms are what's driving the notion of not just software development agility, not just systems engineering development, not just portfolio management agility, but organizational agility as well, national agility, right? And it's not just, you know, a few quick, you know, band-aids on an old bureaucratic organization, right? The key that we've tried to put across, it's not just your executives, it's not just your culture, it's not just your processes, it's the whole organization, right? Smaller, narrower, flatter, fewer people, more automated, faster, billions of users simultaneously, do it right the first time. And do it securely. Right? Any questions or comments?
All right, thank you, Dave. One of the interesting things is that because of the agility of Google Plus, we weren't able to broadcast live tonight. you know, these changes to the system that happened quickly and unbeknownst to the customer happened to us, and we recorded it and we'll play it back. But you know, it's just one of the prices you pay in terms of agility has happened so quickly, you don't even know it happened to you, right?
Anyway, you get it right and you get it wrong, right?
Yeah. So we got questions.
Okay, I have a question. I'm curious. You haven't mentioned anything about companies making these five-year plans. The five-year plan, is that totally out the window? Because I see companies, they seem like they spend 3-4 months with some of their senior leadership to sit down, put together this plan for the next 5 years, and as soon as it's inked up, it's stale, old, it doesn't get done, and then, of course, they do it again the next year. And they spend all those resources, and I'm thinking that, is that finally going to go away so we're actually going to become more agile, and that's the direction that we need to be in?
So I think that was, the question is, what about the five-year plan? Is that a thing of the past? What is the strategic planning, you know, timeline? What is the horizon? So obviously that was a big part of the problem, which led to the notion of strategic agility, right? Our timelines are too long. The Japanese talked about the 100-year plan, right? And we all aspire to be Japanese, right? And we all aspire to be Japanese, right? So that was actually part of the problem, right? It was our strategic horizon was too long, right? So we got, you know, 30-year plans and 15-year plans and 5-year plans. So I'm not sure what the right answer is, but the answer is, yeah, we need to shorten the time horizon pretty quickly. I think we talked about it the last time. There's a great book by Michael Schrade called The Innovator's Hypothesis, one of the best books. And he talked a little bit about the notion of how do you plan in an agile world? And he actually came up with a statistical methodology for decision making, right? How do you rapidly make quantitative decisions under these kinds of circumstances? So I think the answer to your question is we need to shorten it. We can't give it up completely, can't throw the baby out with the bathwater. So the five-year plan probably isn't an evil. It's probably not, you know, evil, but in addition to the five-year plan, we've got to respond to faster changing market threats. Any other?
It's maybe something to do with a Wall Street that you have to have maybe some of these things inside your prospectus for being, you know, listed on the New York Stock Exchange or something along those lines, and that's why these plans have to still be created?
So is it tied to like going public in Wall Street and public? I haven't really thought about that so much. I guess when Agile started taking off in the last 10 or 15 years, people blamed it on short attention span. It was only an American phenomenon because we wanted everything. We wanted our you know, it was a fast food culture, you know. We just had no patience, and thus Agile methods sort of rose, but really wasn't related to that. I think we have another question over here.
Yeah, you mentioned a couple of things initially about your smartphones, iPads, you know, doing a quick update. What about the issues of hardware improvements? It's almost like planned obsolescence every 3, 6 months or year on hardware. They're bringing new hardware out. It's not exactly green. But what about in this agility, when you're talking about your constraints on software and, standards you have to meet, and that relates to, design into the test phase. The other issue is, decades ago we had communication systems, missile systems for satellites, or remote programming on missile silos to do software changes. So the question is, what about your constraints, software, hardware, standards into the validity and verification and tests?
So, okay, that's a very, very complex question. I'm not sure if I got it all, but
it's not easy to, issues.
I'll try to address some of it. So obviously, your organization, your system of systems has to be, engineered with some thought in an agile, flexible way. The internet, for example. There's a great book, I believe it's Robert Reed, wrote it about 10 or 15 years ago, called Architects of the Web, 1,000 Days That Built the Future of Business. And it's a great, great book about how the architects of the modern World Wide Web tried to address this notion of flexibility for building large-scale systems of systems. But obviously, if our infrastructure and technologies don't support it, let's take naval helicopters, right? It just takes a few thousand dollars to do a software upgrade in the embedded chips, right? But it takes millions of dollars to actually send people out to the field and install the software. So the cost of making the change is small, but the cost of implementing the change is high. So if your system of systems is inflexible to change, well you're having some problems, right? So we have to start thinking about that. If I deploy 1,000 helicopters, can they be internetworked? So if I need to evolve the software loads or the mission data loads, I can do that in real time, just like a Samsung or a Google or a Yahoo would do that to smartphones. Any other questions?
Could you comment about how organizational structures evolve for agile businesses? Because there's got to be a change. You mentioned culture and other factors, so I would think organizational structure would need to change. Span of control, responsibilities, more autonomy. How does that play into an agile business?
Yes, and I'm not trying to be funny. Yes, everything you just mentioned, everything. There's actually a set of concepts. They're sort of all rage in the global management and innovation community called holacracy. And it's all about, the notion of how you organize for these types of organizations. I'm a lot simpler person. I use terms like flatter and smaller and fewer, but there are very, very fancy terms like holacracy and teams, and things like that. Sorry. But we'll talk some more. You can come up to me afterwards. Is there another question back here? Go ahead.
Testing. There we go. I was wondering, have you thought about the dark side of this situation? It's interesting when you think about like something like a Pinterest type company worth billions of dollars and yet only have maybe 100 people on their payroll. And yet you have something like GM that has like hundreds of thousands of people and they're worth less. And so are we going to get to the point where now you've got more, you've got less people doing more, what about the people being left behind? So it's kind of a scary situation. Dark side of it. Have you thought about it?
Have I thought about it? Sure, of course I have. Sure, of course I have, right? So we've always, that's a political question, but we've always assumed, you know, to me, this is my opinion, we've always equated manufacturing to employability and strong economy, right? And if we don't have a manufacturing sector and we don't have millions of people employed in manufacturing jobs, we don't have a strong economy, right? So what's the effect of displacing manufacturing workers, right, with high-tech workers that might not even be in our own country? Is it going to have an effect on our economy? And the answer is yes, of course it is. Is it going to be a, well, I've already used the word extinction-level event, but I didn't mean that in a societal sense. I meant that in an organizational sense, right? So there's a series of books written. One of my favorites is Unleashing the Killer Apps by Larry Downs and Chunkamui, but a more recent one, I can't think of the author, is called The Zero Marginal Cost Society. And they talk about the reorganization of society around this particular economic model. So if you're really interested in how this type of an economic model is going to not only affect the U.S. economy, but all the economies, the global economy, the global village, I highly recommend looking at the zero. So, of course, I'm trying to think of his name, Daniel, the guy from the 1960s that won a Nobel Prize, he called it the post-industrial state. He predicted in the 1960s that the U.S. and all post-industrial nations would move out of their manufacturing stage into low-cost, you know, service-paying jobs, and nobody would have any money, and everybody would revolt, and we would redo the country, basically. And he won a Nobel Prize for saying that, right? But I don't think we believe that anymore. Yes, I think we've already seen this in the last 20 years. We've seen a little bit of global depression. We attribute it to energy prices, and that's correct. We attribute it to war and conflict, and that's correct. But being a technologist, what I see in that global depression is I see a market correction as we move to this type of an economic model where the workers are spread globally in India, in Europe, in China, in Africa, and the post-industrial nations move out of their manufacturing stages. And Japan has been hit extremely, extremely hard in the last 20 years. We thought in the 1990s that we would never see the end of the strong Japanese economy, but by the end of the 1990s, you know, they just couldn't even keep pace with the rest of the world. That's why I went to Japan in 1993, because we believed the Japanese economy was going to take off. And I'm not an economist, but I was only there a year, and I could see the Japanese economy collapsing.
All right, well, thank you. One little comment is that in terms of manufacturing, you know, even the Apple computer and the Apple phones are now being automatically manufactured by robots, and so that takes a lot of the Chinese that were doing the slave labor, you know. So anyway, next thing we're going to do is we're going to draw some books.
Yep, absolutely. So we're going to give away three books. The first one, Promised by Gundars, that's a pretty good book, is leadership agility, which is a hot topic, right? I think I think Suzette has presented that here by Bill Joyner and Steve Josephs. Let's go ahead and we'll give a couple of books on business agility away. Well, let's start with leadership agility here. So we'll read the last three digits, hopefully are significant digits. 945, anybody have 945 for the gentleman in the yellow shirt? All right.
Together,
give that to the guy in the yellow shirt.
I didn't have my glasses.
That's all right.
Stay here for a picture.
Last three digits, 953. Who's one more? All right. And one last book, 948.
All right, David. Okay.
Take your choice. Okay. All right. All right. Thank you very much for attending.
Let me take a picture.
Sure, sure.